Hello students, so we have started chapter number 10 of organic chemistry. Hello alkane and hello arene. Till now we have discussed preparation of hello alkane, nomenclature, and we have also discussed SN1 SN2 reaction chemical properties, right? Okay, today we are going to start a new topic. That topic belongs to stereochemistry. So stereochemistry is a branch of chemistry in which we study configuration, spatial arrangement of molecules, right? So today we are going to discuss some basic terminologies of stereochemistry, or we can say optical chemistry or optical compounds. So some basic terminologies. So first terminology is optical activity. And plane polarized light. Okay. So what is optical activity and plane polarized light? So this is a light source. Now from any light source, light will be emitted in all the directions, as we know, right? From any light source, light emits in all the directions. So light is emitting in all the direction, or we can say that light is emitting in all the planes, right? So suppose this is light source. So light will be emitted in all the planes, here, here, here and here, right? So light can be emitted in any plane. Now, if we put a prism before the light source, or we can say Nicol prism, spatial type of prism. So what will prism do? So this is many planar light, right? This light is going in many planes. But what will prism do? Prism will convert this light into plane polarized light. So this light will be converted into plane polarized. So what is plane polarized light? So this light has become, or the light has fallen in one plane only, right? The light used to be fall in all the planes, but after passing through nickel, it has fallen into one plane only. So the light which is in one plane only, so these were the all the planes, but then now the light is in only one plane. So suppose this is the plane, so light is falling in one plane only. So light used to be falling to the all the planes. Now after passing through prism, the light is falling in one plane only, and that light is known as plane polarized light. So the meaning of plane polarized light is the light is in one plane only. Okay, so this is plane polarized light. Now what is optically active compound, or what is optical activity? Okay, now if we take solution of any compound, suppose glucose. So we have got glucose solution. So this is solution of glucose. If we pass this plane polarized light through this solution, there are three possibilities. We are passing plane polarized light through glucose solution. So after passing through glucose solution or any compound, total three possibilities are there, right? One possibility is there, light will not be transmitted in any direction, it won't be rotated, it will go straight, right? First possibility is light can go in straight direction. Second possibility is there, light can go in left direction or light can go in right direction. So after passing plane polarized light through any solution, three possibilities are there. Light can go in straight direction, light can go in left direction, or light can go in right direction. Okay. But if light is not rotating, which means light is going in straight direction, we can say that compound is optically inactive. This is glucose solution, but as we know, glucose is rotating light, though glucose is optically active. But if any compound is there, which does not allow light to rotate. So if light is rotating in straight, if light is not rotating at all, light is going in straight direction, then we can say that compound is optically inactive. Okay. But if light is rotating, so if light is rotating in any direction, whether it is left direction or right direction, we can say that compound is optically active. So simple. If compound does not allow to rotate light, it is optically inactive. If because of the compound light is rotating, then we can say that it is optically active compound. But in that case, if light is rotating in left direction, then we can say that it is levorotatory compound. Levorotatory. And that is indicated by small l or minus sign. Okay. If light is rotating after passing through solution in left direction, we can say that the compound is levorotatory. Levo is a Greek word which means left side, left orientation. So if light is rotating in left direction, we can say that compound is levorotatory. But what about in right direction? So if light is rotating in right direction, then we can say that it is dextrorotatory. The compound is dextrorotatory. Dextro is a Greek word which means right orientation. That is indicated by D or plus. So understand this terminology. We have got a source of light. We are passing this light from the prism. Prism is doing to convert this light into one plane. The function of prism is to produce plane polarized light. Plane polarized light means light in only one plane. Okay. We are passing this light through any solution. There are three possibilities. If light is rotating in left direction, it is levorotatory. If light is rotating in right direction, which is dextrorotatory. If there is no rotation of light, if light is transmitting in straight line only, then we can say that optically inactive compound is there, right? So compound can be optically active or it can be optically inactive. If light is rotating in left direction or right direction, it is optically active. If light is not rotating at all, light is going in straight line, then compound is optically inactive, right? So this is the basic terminology, optical active, plane polarized light. Now, the question is, what makes any compound to be optically active or to be optically inactive? What is the difference between optically active and optically inactive compound that we have seen? But what property of any compound makes it optically active? So the property is, it should be having asymmetric carbon. The compound which is having asymmetric carbon, it should be having asymmetry, or it should be having asymmetric carbon. And because of asymmetric carbon, the compound will be optically active. So the main difference of property is, optically active compound should have asymmetric carbon, and optically inactive compound does not have asymmetric carbon. Now again the question is, sir, what is asymmetric carbon? Okay. So this is carbon. Here group A is there, group B, P and Q. So we have written four different groups attached to carbon. This is A group, B group, P or Q. So if any carbon which is attached with four different functional group or four different atoms is known as asymmetric carbon. So asymmetric carbon is the carbon which is bonded to four different atoms or groups. So this carbon is attaching with four different groups or atoms. So we can say that it is an asymmetric carbon. Here another carbon is there, It has attached with hydrogen, Cl, fluorine. We cannot say that it is an asymmetric carbon. Why? Because it is attaching with same type of atom or same type of group. But for any carbon to be asymmetric, it should be having four different groups. So for any carbon which is having four different atoms or groups, that particular carbon is known as asymmetric carbon. And as we have mentioned, for any compound to be optically active, it should be having asymmetric carbon, right? Because of presence of asymmetric carbon, any compound is optically active. So what are the examples of optically active compounds? So glucose is optically active. Tartaric acid is optically active. So because glucose is having asymmetric carbon, tartaric acid is having asymmetric carbon, so those compounds which are having asymmetric carbon, it should be having optical activity, right? So because of presence of asymmetric carbon, compound becomes optically active. Is it clear? Okay, now we are going to discuss some more basic terminologies of stereochemistry. Next terminology is chiral or achiral. Okay, so two terms are there, chiral and achiral. And the terminology is chirality. Chirality. Okay. Next terminology is chirality. So there can be two types of compounds or two types of objects, chiral and achiral. Now the question is, what is chiral and what is achiral? Okay. So suppose this is my hand, right? If we observe this hand in mirror, so there will be mirror image. So this is the image of my hand. If this is seen in mirror, that will be mirror image against this hand, right? But if we superimpose these two images, if we superimpose these two images, they won't be superimposed. I'm talking about superimposing. Superimposing means it should be overlapped, right? But the image of this hand is not superimposed with the image of mirror. So mirror image and this image is not getting superimposed, then we can say it is chiral. So we can say that chiral is non-superimposable. So any object whose mirror image is not superimposed with that object, then we can say that it is chiral. So which are the alphabets which are non-superimposable? To think about alphabets, right? So which are these alphabets? So suppose E is there. Now mirror image of E will look like this. This is an original image. This is the mirror image. So if you superimpose these two images, it won't be superimposed. So we can say that it is chiral. So many alphabets are like this, E, F, G. Now if you see the mirror image of F, it will look like this. Now this image and this image won't get superimposed, right? So if it is non-superimposable, then we can say that it is chiral. So in short, non-superimposable images are chiral in nature. And opposite to that, Achiral means superimposable objects or compounds. For example, one of the alphabet is O. Now, if you see this O in mirror, it will look like this only, right? Both images can get superimposed, right? O is there, mirror image is O is there. It can be superimposed. So, if if it is superimposed, then we can say that it is achiral. So in short, superimposable images or compounds or objects are achiral, non-superimposable structures are chiral. What is the other example? H. The mirror image of H can get superimposed with this image, right? Then that is achiral. The compounds which are possessing the property of chiral is known as chirality. Chirality is a property. Now, what is chiral carbon? So, chiral carbon is again known as asymmetric carbon. Asymmetric or chiral. So, because of presence of asymmetric carbon, the compound is having chirality, and which means that it can rotate light in any direction. Compound is optically active. So, for any compound to be optically active, it should be having asymmetric carbon or chiral carbon. So, another definition of chiral or asymmetric is mirror image is not superimposed, right? So, asymmetric carbon is the carbon which is having four different groups and the mirror image won't be superimposed. So, that is chiral only. So, chiral and asymmetric are same. Okay. Now, we'll discuss, this is the example of chiral and achiral. We'll discuss some chemical examples. For example, propane dual. We will draw the structure of propane dual. So this is propane dual. Right? This is propane dual. Now we will draw the structure like this. CH3 H OH and CH3. This is propane dual. Now if you see the structure of propane dual, this carbon is having two methyl groups, one H and one OH. So it is not having asymmetric carbon. The definition of asymmetric carbon is it should be having four different groups, but this carbon is having two methyl groups which are same. So this carbon is symmetric carbon. It is not asymmetric carbon. So if it is not having asymmetric carbon, we can say that it is achiral. And the other reason is, if you see the mirror image of this propane dual, this image and mirror image will be superimposed. So propane dual mirror image and its original image getting superimposed, and that is why it is achiral. So there are two definitions of achiral, right? It should not be having asymmetric carbon and the mirror image of each is not superimposed. Mirror image is superimposed. So the mirror image is getting superimposed, that is achiral. Achiral means it should not be having asymmetric carbon, and achiral means mirror image is superimposable. The mirror image is superimposable, then that is achiral. Now we'll see example of butane dual. This is example of butane dual, CH3CHOH, CH2CH3. This is butane dual. Okay, now we'll draw the structure of butane dual like this. HOH, CH2, CH3. Now if you see this carbon is having methyl, ethyl, hydrogen and OH, which are different. So this carbon is having four different groups. So if any carbon is having four different groups, then that is known as asymmetric carbon, or we can say that chiral carbon. So this compound is chiral in nature, but this compound is optically active. So for any compound which is having asymmetric or chiral carbon, that is optically active. And this compound is not having asymmetric carbon, that is optically inactive, or that is achiral, right? Now the butane dual, the image of this compound in the mirror image won't get superimposed. They are non-superimposable. So if mirror image is non-superimposable, so butane dual and its mirror image is not getting superimposed, then that is chiral. Propane dual and its mirror image is getting superimposed, then that is a chiral. So if mirror image is superimposable, then a chiral. If mirror image is non-superimposable, then that is chiral. So I hope you are clear about what is chiral and a chiral. Non-superimposable, chiral. Superimposable, a chiral. Right? So butene to all is chiral and propane to all is a chiral. Okay. I hope you are clear about this terminology. Now we are going to discuss some more terminology. Next terminology is enantiomer. Very easy. Non-superimposable mirror images are known as enantiomers. So those compounds which are non-superimposable. So the original compound and its mirror image is non-superimposable, then these are known as enantiomer. So we can say that those compounds whose mirror image is non-superimposed, then they are known as enantiomers, right? Next definition is nacemic rupture. Okay, what is that nacemic rupture? So we have seen that if light is rotating in right direction, it is dextrorotatory. If light is rotating in left direction, it is levorotatory. So if any mixture which is having dextro plus levo, the mixture which is having combination of dextro and levo, dextro is 50% and levo is 50%. So 50% dextrorotatory compound and 50% levorotatory compounds, that particular mixture is known as racemic mixture. Now, understand this point. The mixture is having equal amount of dextrorotatory and levorotatory compound. Now, if you pass light from this solution, which is having equal amount of dextro and levo, the light will go in straight direction. It won't get rotated. And because of that, we can say that racemic mixture is optically inactive. Or we can say that optical activity of racemic mixture is zero because it has got 50% dextro and 50% levo. So light won't be rotated in right direction or light won't be rotated in left direction. Light will go in straight direction. So if light goes in straight direction, we can say that it is optically inactive or the optical activity of this mixture is zero. Now, if we convert enantiomer into racemic mixture, the process of conversion of enantiomer into racemic mixture is known as racemization. So racemization is conversion of enantiomer into racemic mixture. Okay. Now, third terminology is dissolution. What is resolution? So racemic mixture is having equal amount of dextrorotatory and levorotatory compound. If we separate dextro and levo, so dextro is separated and levo is separated, then that is known as resolution. So resolution is separation of dextrorotatory and levorotatory compound from racemic mixture. Separation of dextrorotatory and levorotatory compound into separate beaker or separation of dextro and levo is known as resolution. So resolution is separation of racemic mixture. Okay, so these are the terminologies of stereochemistry. Two terminologies are left which we are going to discuss in next video lecture. Okay.